Today we talk about Dwarf Kings Hold Dead Rising. It is a fantasy game published by Mantic Games. It's for two players. A player will take the role of a group of heroic dwarfs, and the other player will take the role of the evil necromancer guiding a legion of undead monsters. It is, in essence, a game of tactical combat. It is very straightforward, linear, and simple. It is really mainly move, attack. You do not have a huge variety of other things to do, or items, spells, special abilities, skills, traps to disarm, all those things that you find in many fantasy games these days. Not here. Really, you move, you attack, you beat up the undead or the dwarf, and keep doing that, hoping that you can deal more damage than the opponent does. The game comes with miniatures for the dwarves and their undead enemies, but these miniatures really need some assembly. As you can see, there are a lot of small pieces on this spruce, so you have to take all these pieces apart, and then putting them together takes some work. Also, because only some of the figurines can be assembled just by clicking the pieces together, most of them need to be glued together. Sometimes you really have a lot of small pieces to glue together. Sometimes there is an arm that needs to be glued to a torso, and then a sword needs to be glued to the hand of that arm. As you can see, actually started trying to build in those, well, actually just trying to separate the pieces, and look how small they are. It really, there is detail there, but there's also going to be a lot of work before you can actually play the game. And I guess that if somebody is into miniatures and likes putting together miniatures and painting miniatures, then the person can have fun doing this. But I just like the idea of, you know, playing games out of the box. I'm interested in the gameplay, so I just gave up after it took me forever just to do this. Now I just play the game with the miniatures from Wrath of Ashardalon and Castle in Ravenloft. They work just fine, but you know, this is something that in a review I think needs to be addressed. If you just want to get the game to play it out of the box, well, this is not the right choice, maybe because there is some homework to do before you can start. If you like miniatures, actually, once they are completed and painted, they look good. I saw pictures online, but if I had done it, they wouldn't look that good anyway, so why try? The rulebook is pretty small, also it is not too long. It is, I would say, well written. A lot of illustrations, a lot of examples. The game is straightforward and pretty simple, so maybe it would have been hard to mess up the rules, but you know, sometimes writers of rulebooks really manage to do even that. However, this is not, the rules are not an issue here. A small issue is that during the game you need to reference this table and this table here all the time and have been buried in the rulebook. There is no player aid that comes with the game. Lucky enough, somebody did make a player aid that collects these two tables and other relevant information, and that player aid is available on BoardGameGeek, and you can just download it and print it, and I do recommend that you do that before you start playing the game. The rules occupy 13 pages of the rulebook, and then you have the scenarios. You have six scenarios. Not too many, but six is a good number to start with. And these scenarios, I would say that there is enough variety in there. They do feel different from one another. They have very different sizes, as you can see. Also, I would say that the games that I played ended all pretty close. So I think that the authors did a good job in balancing the scenarios for the two sides. Each player in the game has a pool of action tokens. This is the pool for the necromancer, and this is the pool for the dwarf player. The scenario will instruct you on the number of tokens that you can keep in your hand in each game, and during a turn, the active player will spend as many tokens as he wants and can to activate units. Units are activated for movement and or combat, and the tokens that have a number on indicate the number of miniatures that can be activated by playing that token. For example, if the necromancer player plays this token here, then he can activate three figurines, not the same figurine three times. It's always the number of figurines. The only way to activate a figurine more than once in the same turn is for the dwarf player by using this token here with this symbol here. This is the follow-on token. By spending this, the dwarf player can activate a miniature that was already activated, but in this extra activation, it can perform only one of the two actions, either move or attack, not both. At the end of the turn, the necromancer player will receive one new action token from the pool. The tokens are always drawn randomly, and the dwarf player will receive as many tokens as he needs to go back to his maximum hand size. Once you decide the scenario you want to play, then you build the dungeon following the instructions of the scenario and using these tiles here. They look nice, are fairly sturdy, but they're also pretty thin, and I know that some people complain about such things. Each player has only three types of characters that he can use. The Necromancer uses skeletons and revenants, and also there is a third type of character, a supporting character, a really minor character, that is the Skeleton Hound, not as important as the other two. The Dwarf player has two types of dwarves that have slightly different abilities, and then he also has a pet, which is the Mastiff. Again, same thing, a minor supporting character. So overall, you do not have a huge variety of characters, heroes, monsters, abilities to choose from, because both dwarves and the two undead, they really play very similar to one another. So there's a little bit of a limitation there. Once you activate a character by using one of your activation tokens, then you can move that character by a number of squares up to the movement value of that character, and the movement value of the different characters can be found in those tables I showed you earlier. Once you activate a character for movement, then you can move the character orthogonally or diagonally, it is exactly the same. If characters do have facing, the three squares in front of the character and also the ones at the sides of the character all count as front, only the three in the back count as rear. However, the facing only is taken into account during combat, not during movement. During movement, you just move in any way you want, and you just have to commit to a facing once you end movement with that figurine. Also, once you move adjacent to an enemy figurine, then you have to stop movement immediately. During combat, both the attacker and the defender will roll a number of dice equal to the number that you see here in this table, and this number will be modified by several factors, like for example being outnumbered or being injured or being attacked from the rear. In all these cases, the player loses a die, but it's not too many of these modifiers. The combat will still be pretty straightforward. After you roll the modified number of dice, then you compare the results individually. You do not add the results together. For each roll where the attacker rolled higher than the defender and you rolled higher than the armor of the target, then the attack is a hit, deals a point of damage, otherwise it's a miss. For example, if the dwarf is attacking the skeleton, dwarf rolls a 6, the skeleton a 4, then 6 is both higher than what the skeleton rolled and higher than the armor of the skeleton, then that attack is a hit. If the dwarf had rolled a 2 and the skeleton a 1, 2 is higher than 1, but still not higher than the armor, so that attack would be a miss. Then you check this table to see what is the actual damage that comes from the hit that you just dealt. Any dwarf that receives a hit becomes injured, and you will place an injury marker under that figurine to remind you of that condition, and any injured dwarf that takes a point of damage, takes a damage, is dead. So basically two injuries will kill a dwarf. Skeletons and revenants are a little tougher that way, because if you only deal one damage in a combat, there's no effect, you just shake their bones a little and nothing else. If you deal two hits, then they are boned, meaning that you replace their figurine with a pile of bones token. Later, however, the Necromancer can reanimate that pile of bones by spending an action from his action pools, and he can convert that pile of bones into an actual undead figurine, which can be sometimes tricky. There will be piles of bones on the board at the beginning as per setup instructions. Other piles of bones will be created during combat, and if the dwarf player is not careful, he ends movement adjacent to one of these piles of bones, then the Necromancer can bring out a figurine out of that pile of bones and can immediately attack. So it can be a little tricky there. The dwarf player has to be careful about that. Three hits on any figurine will just destroy the figurine for good. You have a couple of other elements. The dwarves have this ability to hide in the shades, and so you can hide them under a counter, and you have dummy counters to fool the Necromancer. The Necromancer has some special abilities that can be used from time to time, but overall this remains a pretty basic, straightforward game. Move, attack, attack, move. There isn't a huge variety of other things that can be done. And because of this, to me, it's a game that has pluses and minuses. On the plus side, the scenarios have enough variety, I think, and they seem pretty well balanced. The game is easy to set up, to teach. Most scenarios play in under an hour, so you have flexibility if you don't have much time to play. Miniatures, to me, are on the minus side because I don't have the time and expertise to put them together well. For other players, it would be a plus. On the minus side, to me, there is not so much what is in this game, but what I do not find in this game, which is I do not find much theme. With only three characters on the good side and three characters on the bad side, and these characters are pretty similar to one another. You can't really customize them, and there are no items, spells, situations, events that happen that you find in many fantasy games these days. It just feels a pretty abstract game. I don't have such a strong sense of theme coming from it. It is really tactical combat. At the same time, that kind of tactical combat is not that deep because, well, when you're moving, for example, facing doesn't matter, so you never have to worry about ending movement with the wrong facing. You always get the right one. There aren't so many ways in which you can modify the number of dice that will be rolled. So it, in a way, becomes your next move pretty often becomes fairly obvious, and because of this, combat can be a little repetitive, and since you will be doing it a lot during each game, that can be a problem, especially in the longer scenarios. So I would say that overall, this is really the point. After I played games that are more thematically rich, like Wrath of Ashardalon or Crypt Master, or games that are more tactically deep, such as Space Hulk, then it is hard for me to go back to a game which is that linear, that simple, that straightforward. It can still be fun. Some scenarios are definitely entertaining. However, I think that if you're expecting something more than what it is, then the game can be a little disappointing.